welcome. Wendy and I were just having a giggle back there, talking about how old we were when we thought we might actually be good at something. Yeah. And, you know, because my mother was a professional ballerina at the age of 12. And
professional.
Yeah, I know, isn't it crazy? Like, Ballanchine picked her out of the ballet studio when she was 12. And I said to Wendy, so how old were you when you knew you were good?
I was 12 when I thought I was good.
That's kind of amazing. And I said, did you just know it, or did someone tell you?
Someone told me, yeah.
And you're grateful to that person?
I am, yeah.
For the rest of your life?
Yes. You had the same...
Yeah, I was 11. I wasn't any good at ballet. So they weren't saying that. No, I was sent to a pretty serious ballet school from the age of 8 to 16, and we did 2 hours of ballet a day, 5 days a week. And being Baronova's daughter was a huge burden because, you know, great expectations, and I disappointed everybody. And it was kind of crushing to have to go out there day after day in the studio and look at yourself in the mirror and know that you weren't going to be a great ballerina like your mother. And I was sort of tall and skinny, and in my black leotards and tights, I just looked like an epileptic spider.
That was my whole career.
It was awful. It was awful. And, you know, I just had this idea that I was a person who just wasn't any good at anything. And I mean, I was good in the classroom, but that didn't matter. Nobody cared. If you weren't good in the ballet studio, you were nothing. Mm-hmm. And one day I was sitting with a couple of girls, and we were talking about the acting classes, and I said, I wonder if anyone's any good at the school. There were 350 girls in the school. And one of the girls said, well, the acting teacher says there are 3 girls here who are any good. And I said, really, who are they? And she said, well, you're one of them. I thought, me? I mean, it was the first time that I thought I could be good at anything. And the teacher never said it to me, never made me feel I was anything at all, but just the idea that someone thought I could be good at something.
Well, to was have like, a parent,
wow,
that's
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it was fantastic.
Yeah.
And then I was thinking, you know, with my mum, who had her first ballet lessons when she was 7 in Romania. And she'd never seen ballet, she didn't know what ballet was, she'd mm-hmm. never seen a photograph or been to watch a ballet. And she was holding on to the edge of a kitchen table in a sort of slum apartment behind the factories while the teacher hummed the music because there was no piano or music, you know. Mm-hmm. So Granny and the teacher would sit on the teacher's bed and they would go la, da, la, 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 and the girls would. Mum had no clue what she was doing. She thought, this is stupid. And Granny goes home to Grandpa and says, well, she has to see a ballet. She doesn't know what she's doing. She has no concept of what it's about.
And your Granny knew all about, she loved ballet.
Granny loved ballet. She was making Mum live her dream. Mm-hmm. And then when my mother finally saw a ballet and she thought, oh my God, that's what ballet is. And from that moment on, it was like the light went on. Mm-hmm. And this amazing teacher, bless her heart, when the light went on, the teacher said to Granny, this girl has something. Mm-hmm. But you have to take her away from me right away. I'm going to ruin her. I'm not good enough for her. This girl has to go to Paris, to Olga Preobrazhenska. Mm-hmm. And I think the generosity of the teacher mm-hmm. to make that happen. And then the generosity of Olga Preobrazhenska when this destitute Russian refugee family shows up in Paris and she says, I'll take her, and I can see you can't pay me. I can see you have no money, mm-hmm. but I'll take her anyway. And if she makes a go of it, she can pay me then. Mm-hmm. And you
had a similar, well,
amazing.
Similar situation where my parents didn't have a lot of money either. And we had actually teachers from the Royal Ballet and London Festival Ballet, and they let me come and take classes for free, and they let me take every single day if I wanted to. And
wow.
So I did, yeah. And my whole childhood, I don't know if my parents ever paid for my ballet lessons.
That's amazing. So,
yeah, I mean, the generosity of these, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm just going to click on since we have this. Yeah. So that's my granny, who's pretty scary granny. And that's Grandpa in his Russian Imperial Navy uniform. And that's Granny's father, who was a general in the Imperial Guard. And that's the Tsar. My grandpa was a sort of amateur photographer and artist and quite talented. And he and his best friend Sablin, sitting behind the Tsar here, were rowing the Tsar from battleship to battleship in a naval review. And he took this lovely picture of them laughing. And, you know, of course, not that long after, the Tsar and his family were shot in a basement in Siberia. And Sablin, when his ship went over to the Bolsheviks, the sailors knocked a ship's nail through the top of the officers' heads, and he was one of them. And there's my mum.
Age seven. On point,
yes. Well, yeah. You know, when did you go on point?
Well, luckily I was a little bit more old school. Well, I don't know if that's good. Not as old school as that. I think I went on point at eight or nine.
Right.
But nowadays, kids don't go on point till around 12.
See, my mom always thought...
11 or 12, yeah.
That this was the right age. Mm-hmm. Not to do a whole class on point.
Right, just a little bit.
But little by little, every day, to get your feet used to it, to get your muscles used to it. And she thought that prevented injuries later on because you grew up with this organic sense of how you had to be on your toes.
Huh. Well, she might have been right.
And that was the ballerina that inspired my mother when she saw ballet for the first time. Her mother somehow managed to get the money out of Grandpa, who was working in a factory, to go to the theater to see Karsavina dance. And when she saw that for the first time, that's when the light went off. And so who was the first dancer you saw?
The first dancers I saw were in Louisville, so they were a little more regional, but they were good. But in Louisville, when I was a young kid, Patricia McBride came.
Oh.
And Mikhail Baryshnikov, when I was about maybe like 10 or 11. And one of the first ballets I really remember seeing was La Sonnambula. When I was about 10, Patricia McBride. And I did that on my farewell performance.
Oh, how
after 37 years of practicing for it. So, yes.
How cool.
So I got to see that kind of wonderful dancer.
Right. Mm-hmm. So that's Olga Preobrazhenska, who was the dancer herself, a great dancer, who, along with a lot of other white Russian refugees, ended up in Paris as a teacher, who took my mother on for nothing. And to help these starving, destitute white Russian refugee families out, the little girls who she took for nothing, she would send out on Sundays to the rich ladies' mansions to dance for their tea parties. And my mum's always said it was so difficult because they had to go on point on these thick carpets while the ladies were having tea and do the turns. But afterwards, she would be taken to the kitchen and the butler would give her a delicious slice of cake and a glass of milk, and then surreptitiously an envelope with some cash in it to her mum, you see.
Wow.
And a few years later, not that many years later, because she was already a prima ballerina at the age of 13, there was the opening of the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo at the Opera House in Paris, and the Marquis de somebody or other gives a big party, a gala opening party at his beautiful house, and the whole company is invited, and there's a tent out the back, and he, you know, oysters and champagne, and he gets to his feet and, you know, tap, tap, tap on the glass. I would like to welcome Madame Baronova to my house. This is such an honor to have you. And she said, oh, but I've been here before. Only last time I ate in the kitchen.
Wow.
She danced with his mother.
That's amazing.
So have you ever had a party given for you after an opening?
No, but when you started to tell the story, I thought about my teacher, who was similar in giving me my free classes, and she was from Paris, but she was living in Louisville, and she had studied at the Paris Opera Ballet. And when I was 12, or maybe even 11, our class was taken to dance for the soldiers at Fort Knox. And we did
Paris
the French can-can for them. At 12, screaming, splits, hops, garters, the whole thing.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's that's my teacher. Have to give the soldier something.
Wow.
We had a good time, but it's a little bit funny. We didn't get food or anything after. We didn't get money or anything. No gold bricks. But good stories for later.
When Mum first met Olga Preobrazhenska, she was taken to the studio to be introduced to her, and Preobrazhenska was in a terrible mood that day. She was shouting at everybody, and Mum was terrified. And the pianist said to Granny, "Oh, this is a very bad day for Madame. Her husband left her this morning for one of her pupils."
Oh.
And so Mum was just terrified because she was shouting. She kept trying to hide behind the piano, you know. And the whole of that first year, she was just frightened of Madame, who was very strict and sort of yelling a lot. And then at the end of that first year, the White Russian Imperial Naval Officers Club had their annual fundraiser, and in rotation they would go to the three great ballet studios in Paris and ask for girls for the performance for the fundraiser. And this year it was Preobrazhenska studio, so my mother gets to go out on stage and do, you know, her first performance. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the shy little girl, she said once she got on stage and she heard the music, she was just, you know, transported, and she could let herself go. And she came off stage, and Preobrazhenska said, "My God, what happened? Every day I see you in class, and your body and the technique is fantastic, but up here there's nothing. And out there you are alive and emotional. What happened?" Mum said, "Well, I'm just so frightened of you because you shout at me and I can't feel anything at all."
Yeah.
And the woman never shouted at her again. She just hugged her and she said, "I'll never do that again."
Wow.
And it gave her permission to be free. Were you always emotionally accessible to yourself? I mean, did you ever have something you had to get over to get out there and perform?
No, I didn't. I don't think I had that quality of performance, freedom, and sort of, I don't know. I was never told I had something that special at all. But I do remember just now thinking about when I was around 12 again. We were doing Giselle. I was one of the children in Giselle. And something had fallen off a costume. And nobody taught me to do this, but I thought, I have to go pick that up. So I made a little beeline and, "Look, Mommy, look what I," and I took it off the stage, you know, and I made up a story, and the directors were like, "That was amazing. You just cleaned the stage up for us, and no one taught you how to do that, and you made it into something, and good job."
You were free.
Yeah,
free,
so I guess I did creative. Know a little, I just had that instinct, but I didn't have.
Cool. One day, two strange men came into the studio, and it was George Ballanchine and Colonel de Bazile, and they're looking for dancers for the new company, Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo. And the only sort of big ballet companies that had been around at the time, Diaghilev's and Pavlova's, had both been closed for 2 years out of business because Pavlova and Diaghilev were dead. And there was no work for the dancers. They were, you know, doing vaudeville and music halls, anything to keep a roof over their heads. So finally there was this new company, and Ballanchine, who was a young choreographer at the time, ballet master. They were thrilled there was employment finally, but Ballanchine said, "I am not interested in recreating, you know, Diaghilev and the big 1001 Night type spectacles. I want young, I want fast, I want fresh, I want modern." And that's why he went around the studios looking for young girls. And he picked three of them: Tamara Tumanova, Tatiana Ryabushinska, and Irina Baronova. And when my mum's parents were told that she had been picked and invited to join the company, they said, "But she's 12. She's still at school. There's no way she can go and join a ballet company." And they were talked into it, because de Basile could talk anyone into anything. Mm. And you can see there she is in one of his new ballets. That's Concurrence. And the costumes by Derain. Mm. And she's 12 years old. It's unbelievable, really. Mm-hmm. I mean,
it's unbelievable. It really is.
That's Miro designed.
Again, at 12.
Yeah, and she was invited. At the end of the first year, there was a two-month summer break, and Serge Lifar invited her to partner him to earn some extra money at the fancy French resorts of Deauville and Trouville and Biarritz. Mm. And that was the first time that she was really partnering a leading dancer. And she said it was the first time that she got taught by the dancer who was rehearsing them about the acting side of ballet, Inspector La Rose. Mm-hmm. He said, you know, when you come into the room and you're holding the rose, we have to see in your mind that you're thinking of the ball you've just been to and the young men that you danced with and the handsome guy who gave you the rose, but you're so tired that you fall asleep in the chair. I mean, the bed's in the other corner. Why didn't you get into bed? Mm-hmm. It's because you were so tired that while you were daydreaming about the young man, you fell asleep in the chair. The audience has to see that, or it makes no sense at all. Why are you walking out holding a flower? They've got to see this, even though you don't say it, and you don't really at that point dance it. And so when was it that you understood that just apart from dancing, there's the whole acting side of it?
Well, we were told never to act from Balanchine. Mm-hmm. That was his thing. But, I mean, I never actually knew Balanchine, but that's the story that comes down. But the feeling thing, they didn't teach us that either. They didn't really, I had learned that, I figured that out on my own. I figured it out by watching, I think, other people. And from sort of being coached and using my imagination with sort of visuals and, you know, sort of seeing ideas, but not really taught how to feel things. Maybe Jerry Robbins had that kind of effect.
Oh, right.
He would push people, push their buttons a little bit and try to bring it out of you. But it had to be really you. It had to be the honest side, something of you. But less theatrical than maybe that time.
Yeah, so at the end of their first year, Balanchine left and Miassine came in. Again, you can see what a kid she is. And she said that it was a very different way of working, that Balanchine at that time had been a barrel of laughs, you know. It was in rehearsal break when the pianist got up to go to the bathroom and have a pee or something, he would sit at the piano and play Boogie Woogie and all the dancers would. She said it was one big party. And then when Miassine came in, it was, you know, serious business. Out came the notebooks, they were put on the chairs, and this is, you know, we're going to try this step and that step, and it was completely different. And she said it was a wake-up call that it wasn't all party, that it was work. And how, so how was it when you were at New York City Ballet? Was Balanchine?
I think it's just with different choreographers. I think there's the more organic choreographers that just kind of come in with an open slate. Let's see what we can do right now. You know, Christopher Wheeldon is like that.
Yeah.
But yet, Rhett Mansky, he comes in very prepared. He knows what he wants you to do and how he wants you to do it. And then you play off of that. So it's just, I think each artist has their own way of doing it.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mom said that Fokine would come in and the whole ballet was in his head. Wow. He just had to transmit the information to the dancers. Everything down to the tiniest detail was already in his head. He'd worked it all out and he'd timed it already to the music.
Yeah.
And with Miassine, he would try, he would, you know, the first few bars of the music, he'd try it this way, then he'd make up a completely different steps. He'd do six different versions.
I think Jerry Robbins might have been like
then he'd
more
move
like
on to the next, you know, few bars of music. He'd do six different versions. And then he would say, I'll take the second version for that first thing and the fourth version for the second. The glances are going crazy.
Yeah.
You know, trying to remember. Mm-hmm. But another thing that Myasin did was he cast the parts very carefully. Hmm. He cast the dancers for a part. They would be perfect to dance for the character that that part was. Hmm. And then he expected you, like an actor, to bring to the table the physical gestures, the thing that makes it personal and specific. Hmm. And then the part was set. Then the part was made.
So the dancer collaborated.
Exactly.
A lot. Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. Yeah.
Scuola di Ballo. Ah, their first tour, the new baby ballet company on their first tour of Germany, Holland, and Switzerland rented two old buses from the dancer David Lachine's uncle in Paris for a cut rate. And there's some sort of cardboard sign in the back window saying Russian ballet. And then this is the first really modern ballet. Mm. The first ballet where there were no fairies and no swans and no princesses and no men being roses or fawns. This was color and images and shapes and patterns. And it was interpretive to the symphony that was the music. Mm. And it was considered shocking at the time. I mean, now, you know, obviously New York City Ballet is so known for the impressionistic, right? Mm-hmm. But at the time, Myasin's Les Présages was considered sacrilegious by the music world, who said a symphony doesn't need any interpreting. It is its work of art in itself. It's sacrilege to make dancers go out there and interpret the music. Mm. And the art world said, you know, it was like a painting. They're taking abstract art and they're taking costumes and making it part of the painting. You know, a painting is a work of art in itself. It doesn't need to be translated into a ballet. And the ballet world was shocked because where was the prince and the princess and the fairy?
Yeah. Wow.
And this was the beginning of truly modern ballet. And when the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo came to America for the first tour in 1933, they brought Les Présages. They brought 22 ballets with them. And at the end of the first week, New York did not want to see this at all. They wanted the prince and the princess and the fairy. And they couldn't sell the tickets. And one of the leading critics said, you're going to have to bring Petrushka. You've got to get the old stuff back. They don't want to watch this. They're not ready for this. Mm. And so the company played the same six ballets for the next 2 weeks. And they sold so many tickets that the theater involved a stop clause to prevent them going on tour.
Wow.
America wasn't ready for modern at that time.
They brought how many? 23? And they ended up doing only six?
Six. For the first tour, for the first year, because America wasn't ready. Mm. Europe was ready, but America wasn't. Mm-hmm. I love these pictures. The ones that aren't, you know, they're like the professional for the program pictures. This is...
Were these taken by different dancers in the company?
I think by my grandfather. Oh. You know, when they went to the beach on a Sunday on their day off.
Wow.
It's just so beautiful. They're young and they're healthy and they can't stop dancing.
And drawing. That's amazing.
Oh man.
Why isn't this?
There we go. And so Myasin's next ballet was Beach. And it was a homage to Monte Carlo for the Royal Gala to say thank you for being a host and a home for our company. Raoul Dufy did the decor. Yeah. And then they went to London for the first time and they presented Les Présages and it was a huge success and everyone was backstage taking off their makeup and there was and the little girls in their dressing room, they said, someone's here to see you, and it was Karsavina.
Oh.
And my mother said, she went, oh, this is my fairy princess, this is the one I saw when I was seven who made me want to be a dancer. And what I think is so moving is when Karsavina, who became a great friend of my mother's, autographed a photograph for her, she says, "To dear Irina, with all my admiration for your great artistry and love for your dear self, Tamara."
Wow.
I mean, to have your idol, the one who made you want to be a dancer, write that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So,
who is that?
Yes, Patricia McBride.
Well, I, interestingly, I worked with Tanaquil Leclerc on Hayef Divertimento just one day. I had worked with Maria Tallchief the day before, and Maria Tallchief had oodles of information, hundreds of corrections and details, and where are your hands, and how are your hands, and how are your eyes, and every little inch of you. And the next day I did the same thing for Tanny Leclerc, and I went to her and I said, "So, do you have any advice or any thoughts?" She said, "Just be yourself." That was all she said. Don't worry about all those inches of things and details. And then when I made my debut in that, there was a little vase with a little bouquet from her. So I have a little cat card from Love Tan.
Oh.
Yeah, so I have my own little thing. But then also, I think it was 2 years ago, Patricia McBride came backstage. And she came to my dressing room, and we spoke a little bit, and I invited her in, and we talked, and she looked at all the pictures I have in my theater case, and she's in there, Tanny Leclerc, and Patricia McBride, and my teachers, and Ballanchine, and Jerome Robbins, and my husband, but the most special people, and she saw that she was in there, and I explained to her that how special she honestly truly was to me in my life. So I did have a
cool
moment, yeah.
So this was my mother's big break, big break. The three little girls who had been allowed to do the leading parts in the new Ballanchine ballets and the new Miassine ballets, but they weren't allowed anywhere near the great classics. That was for, you know, the great older ballerina, Alexandra Danilova.
Mm-hmm.
And this first season in London, really important, you know, thing for this new company to have and to establish themselves, and Presage had gone really well, and Swan Lake was going to open with Danilova, and the day before, Danilova got sick. And because my mother always watched everyone else's rehearsals and always watched everyone else's performances from the wings, and there was only a day to learn the part, De Basile said, "All right, Baronova's going to do it.
She'll know it, yeah.
She'll know it." And Mama Tamanova had a shit fit. "My Tamara should do it. Why should, you know, Irina shouldn't do it. Tamara should do it." And my granny was upset because Mama Tamanova was upset, and like, "My daughter should do it, not your daughter." And then they said to Lishina, "All right, you're going to dance with Irina tomorrow." And he said, "I'm not going out there with her. She's only 13. I'm not going out there and exposing myself, and she's only got a day to learn the part. No way."
Yeah.
And all this brouhaha, and Anton Dolin, who at the time was the greatest male dancer, walked in and said, "What's going on?" And said, "Well, she's sick, and she's going to replace her, and she wants her daughter to do it, and he won't dance with her." And he said, "What rubbish, I'll do it myself."
Mm-hmm.
And he got her in a taxi, and he took her to Chelsea, where he had his studio, and he gave her a glass of milk.
I'm glad it wasn't wine. I thought you were going to say a glass
a kid,
of wine.
Right? And he explained the part to her, and they opened in Swan Lake the next day.
Wow.
And she was 13, and she said that she stood in the wings, you know, with the little shawl around her, and her mother made the sign of the cross over her and took the shawl. And she steps out. And she wrote in her autobiography, "You know, the thing I will always remember about that great night for me was not just that we did it and we got through it, or that the audience even liked it, but that when it was all over and we were taking our curtain calls, Anton Dolin led me to the front of the stage, and in front of everybody, he kissed my hand."
So beautiful, yeah.
And so who was your great partner.
Well, I just have to say that story reminds me of Jacques Dubois and Suzanne Farrell, because, you know, he was that kind of a man to her. To me, Jacques Soto, of course, was that kind of partner to me. That's an amazing story. I don't have any kind of ever could tell.
Well, to have a great star introduce a new star to the audience, I mean, what a moment.
Yeah. That's an incredible story, though. But Danilova did teach me Swan Lake.
Oh, wow.
Yes, she taught me the White Swan.
Oh.
When I was about 16.
Lovely. And then the great impresario, Sol Hurok, who brought, really, ballet to America. Mm-hmm. He was a Ukrainian emigre, and he started off by organizing entertainment for the labor unions. Mm. And somehow that turned into being the man who brought ballet and opera and music. And he brought the company over to America for their first tour. These are the ballerinas on the ship.
It's great.
Isn't that cool?
That's amazing.
And this is a hokey press photo that Hurok organized, and he was the one who made up the phrase, the baby ballerinas.
Yes, and that's how you sell the tickets.
That's right. And there's Petrushka that was on that program that New York was ready for, and the dancers used to call it ham and eggs.
Oh, really?
Because they could only do the same over and over.
Oh. It's one of my favorite ballets ever, though.
That was the first tour. And I realized when I was making the book and going through the photographs that this picture of Myasin is him looking at early American music record collection.
Wow.
That Gerald Murphy of, you know, the Murphy, Hemingway friendship. He had a collection of rare music, and Myasin was picking recordings to listen to choose the music for the first American ballet called Union Pacific, which was about the making of the railroad. And this was the first ballet that was all American themed. It had cowboys and saloon girls.
Did it premiere in America?
It premiered in America while they were on tour, and that was my mother as the saloon girl.
At age?
13, 14.
I love that.
I know.
Yeah.
And then she met Jerry, who was another white Russian refugee who had a pretty interesting story. He came from Moscow, and his grandfather was a big textile tycoon and a big patron of the arts. Mm. And he supported the ballet and the opera and the theater, and he built a theater at his country estate, and the children took part in amateur dramatics and stuff. And Jerry's mum was this man's daughter, and she liked singing, and it wasn't that she had the greatest opera voice, but she was wealthy, and she was passionate about singing, and she rented a theater, and she hired an opera company, and they did two Tchaikovsky operas, and she sang opposite a tenor, and she fell in love with him, and she married him. And Jerry was one of the children. Huh. And his mother had two brothers, and one wanted to be a dancer, and the other wanted to go into the theater. And they said to their father, "This is what we want to do." And he said, "You must be joking. You can be a patron of the arts, but this isn't going to be your life. This is undignified. You're going to come into the textile business and work with me." And they said, "We don't want to do that." One wanted to be a dancer, and the other wanted to be an actor and a director. And he said, "Absolutely not." And there was a big standoff about it. And the one who wanted to be a dancer caved, and the one who wanted to work in the theater refused to cave. And so the father said to him, his name was Konstantin Alexeyev. He said, "All right, you can have a go, but you're not going to drag the family name through the mud. You're not going to use the name Alexeyev. Go pick some other name." And he chose Stanislavski. Oh. So Jerry came from this very artistic family.
Wow.
His uncle was Stanislavski, and he was a naval cadet in a naval academy when the revolution happened. And the whole academy was put on a battleship and they were trying to escape from the Bolshevik Red Navy, and they were being pursued by a Bolshevik battleship. And the older boys were told to go under the deck and shovel coal into the engine, so full speed ahead. And the younger boys, like Jerry, who was 12, were given guns and were told to stand on deck and shoot at the Bolshevik sailors.
Oh, my God.
And somehow they managed to evade the battleship and then were found drifting off the coast of Turkey by an English ship who towed them into Constantinople. Then the king of Yugoslavia heard that there was a naval academy with no home, and he offered them a disused military barracks. So the end of his schooling was at a Yugoslavian military barracks where the Russian Naval Academy finished the boys' education. And then he joined his father, who had run away to Paris. And they were washing cars, and they ended up driving cars as chauffeurs. And he was hired by the Duesenberg Car Company to drive a Senator Mayo from Colorado and his wife around Paris and show them the sights. And they found him an interesting young man, and they said, well, tell me your story. And Jerry told his story, and they offered him a job in Colorado running their ranch. So he was in Colorado. You can't make this up. So he's running the Senator Mayo's ranch in Colorado, and he hears that a whole bunch of Russians are showing up in New York. He rushes to New York, and he was a distant cousin of Tatiana Ryabushinska. And he immediately falls in love with Danilova. And then de Bazile is impressed by this young man and says, well, why don't you come and be my private secretary? We could do with you and your business know-how. And so he said to Senator Mayo, I want to quit and I want to go with the ballet company. And the senator said, was it the pay? Is it not enough pay? He said, no, they're offering me half what you're giving me. I just want to be with the Russians.
Yeah.
So he joined the company too. And then the romance with Danilova faded, and he took my mother out for an ice cream. And she said...
How old was she now?
Yeah, she was 15.
And, oh, my.
And she said to him, and how old are you? And he said, well, I'm 30. And she repeated this to her parents. Oh, he's so sophisticated, he's 30. And the parents thought, uh-oh, okay. So they said to him, all right, stay away from our daughter. You're not allowed to talk to her. And to my mum, they said, you cannot talk to him. He's absolutely forbidden, which instantly made him the most interesting man in the company.
Yeah.
And so for the next 2 years, they were living on a train together, 6 months of the year touring America, and you know, working all over Europe in the same company, and they weren't allowed to talk to one another. And there's mum's rival, Danilova. And the tours, their first coats, fur coats. Clark Gable and Myrna Loy. And Myasine, he didn't like the train so much. He had a car and a trailer. And
very Hollywood.
That's right. And he and his wife lived in the trailer, and they'd drive, you know, like alongside the train. When they got when they got to Los Angeles, and all the movie stars showed up, you know, Clark Gable and Myrna Loy and Marlene Dietrich, and Dietrich became fascinated with Myasine. Mm. She sat on a chair in the first wing and watched every performance. Mm. And they were doing Union Pacific one night, and two of the corps de ballet got sick, and they needed two dancers to step into their places. They were only playing railroad ties, and they asked for volunteers. And my granny, Mama Baronova, was the only mama who was thin enough to get into the brown sacks that was the railroad tie, but they needed one other railroad tie, and Marlene Dietrich volunteered. So she and Granny were carried on like this and laid down on the ground as wooden railroad ties.
Oh, my God.
And when the gig at Los Angeles was over and they went up the coast to do the gig in Santa Barbara, Marlene Dietrich went too, in the trailer with Myasine and his wife.
Oh, my God.
So did you ever have a fan who followed you around?
No.
No, Marlena.
Okay. I think that's okay.
So this was one of their tours. That's 226 days of performing. Can you believe it?
No.
And on this particular tour was where Mum and Jerry eloped. You know, all this not being allowed to talk to one another and passing each other in the corridors of the train and thing. So they were in New Orleans, I think, and my mother had a break before the evening show and rehearsal, and she went around the corner to a coffee shop hoping that Jerry would be there or that he'd come there at some point. And for 2 hours she sat on the bar stool and hoped he would come, and he didn't. And then she went back to the theater rather sadly, and Granny said, "Where have you been?" And she lied. She couldn't say. She said, "Oh, I've been practicing. I've been at rehearsal." And Granny said, "You're lying to me," and she hit her. And Granny always wore this huge cocktail ring, an amethyst in it, massive. And it clipped her eye, and she had this massive black eye. So it was, you know, a big gossip item that night that Baronova had a shiner out to here that, you know, had to be covered with the makeup. And that night, in the middle of the night, de Basile knocked on Mum's door. And, you know, she slept with the interconnecting door to her parents' room open. She tiptoes to the door and he says, "Show me your face." He says, "I heard about this. What the hell happened?" She said, "I slipped in the bathroom."
Oh, my God.
And he said, "Right, you get a good night's sleep. And tomorrow after class, you come and you tell me the truth."
Yeah.
And she did. And he said, "Do you like Jerry?" She said, "Yes." "Do you love Jerry?" She hardly knew him, right? Mm-hmm. She said, "Yes." "Do you want to marry Jerry?" "Yes."
Sounds like Swan Lake. "Do you love her?" "I swear."
Yeah. And so, as she wrote, you know, her fate was sealed. He said, "Right, well, you know, Hurok and I will come up with a plan and we'll let you know, not a word to anybody." And a few days later, the road manager said to her, "Right, we have a plan. You're going to be in the first ballet on the program, and then you're going to tell your parents you're going to watch the rest of the evening from the auditorium. But you sneak out a door in the back, Jerry will be waiting in a taxi, you get in the taxi, you go to the airport, you fly to Cincinnati, which is our next stop. By the time your parents catch up with you, you'll be married." She's like, "Okay." So my mother did that, and she said she sneaked out of the theater, and in her purse, all she took with her were 6 hair curlers.
She had to look good.
Good. So they flew to Cincinnati, and then Jerry drove her across the state border into Kentucky, because in Cincinnati, in Cincinnati, you had to be 18 to get married, but in Kentucky, you could get married when you were 17.
Or 12. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I don't know. Yes.
Well, it may be 12 now. No. 17 then. So when I was doing research for the book in the New York Public Library, Serge Grigoriev, who was the company manager first for Diaghilev and then for de Basile, all his black notebooks are there, and with the tour lists are written out. And, you know, I copied them out. I'd never seen them written out before. And I'm writing down this tour list, you know, for when my mum eloped with Jerry, and I'm looking at the dates. I'm thinking, well, hang on a minute, what date was that? And they're in Cincinnati, and I realized it was actually 22 days before her 17th birthday. So he drove her across the state line, but she was still only 16.
Wow.
So they were actually illegally married in Kentucky.
Yeah.
And my mother wouldn't have realized this, but I'm sure Jerry did. And then I thought, oh, that's why. Later, when they went on tour, later in the year, they went to Australia. And Mum always said, oh, Jerry said I was so, you know, young and irresponsible, and I had to understand that marriage was a serious business, and he wanted us to get married properly in the Russian Orthodox Church with a priest. And I thought, the hell with it. It wasn't because he wanted her to take it seriously. It was because they weren't actually legally married.
Whoa.
Yeah. So there they were, the newlyweds. And there was a power play at this point between Jerry and Granny, because you can imagine my grandparents when they caught up with them and they eloped and gotten married, mm-hmm. and now who had control of my mother? Mm. And when I thought about what my grandparents had given up, what they had sacrificed for mum to have ballet lessons and then to take her to Paris when they were, you know, so poor that they were hungry, they were starving. I mean, no wonder they felt an ownership mm-hmm. of her career mm-hmm. and a right to own her and her career, so that when she left them to elope and the power transferred to Jerry,
yeah.
you know, a huge shock. And there was a standoff in the dressing room one day, a dancer who was dancing a part that my mother danced before she became one of their leading ballerinas, got a tummy ache and couldn't do the ballet in the second half of the program. And de Basile and Jerry came to Mum and said, you know the part, would you mind, could you do the part now in the second half? And Granny, who always sat in Mum's dressing room, said, absolutely not. She's beyond that. She doesn't do that part anymore. It's not good enough for her anymore. That's a step backwards. And Jerry said, I'm begging you, we don't have anyone who knows the part. Will you please just put the costume on and do the part? And Granny said, absolutely not. She's not doing it. And my mother said, bring me the costume. Granny left the dressing room. By the time Mum got back to the hotel after the theater, the grandparents were walking out with their suitcases. Wow. But then she was free to do what she wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And she had worked with Nijinska
mm-hmm.
on a ballet called Les Cent Baisers, and Nijinska was now doing Les Noces in New York. And my mother went to de Basile and she said, I want to do Les Noces. And he said, but there's no part for you. It's an ensemble. It's all corps de ballet. There's no leading role.
Mm-hmm.
She said, I don't care. I want to work with her. I want to learn more from her.
Mm-hmm.
And de Basile said, but that's crazy. Everyone's trying to get out of the corps de ballet and you want to go back in? She said, I just want to learn. Please, please put me in the ballet. So he did. And they start rehearsing in New York, and Stravinsky comes to the rehearsal and he sits at the piano and he's explaining this music and the rhythms. You know, no one's ever heard anything like mm-hmm. it before. And then he sees my mother and he says, what are you doing here? She said, I just wanted to learn from Nijinska. And he said, you're a clever girl.
Mm-hmm.
So I know one of the things about you is your willingness mm-hmm. to learn,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
No matter how big a ballerina you get, right? There's mm-hmm. always
somebody that will teach you something.
That's new. Right.
Yeah.
And sometimes in very unexpected
yeah.
places, not where you're looking, right?
Right, right, yeah.
Oh, questions. We've got cards. Questions. Where do you both see the ballet world evolving from here?
Oh. We're gonna flip.
I'm handing this over to Wendy.
From here? Well, evolved quite a distance from there.
Yeah.
We've lost our Balanchine, but we have a lot of new, young choreographers making new work for today. So it's, we'll see where it goes. We know where it went from there. And,
that's right.
And we have a long way to go before we actually know where it will go. I think it's definitely going more contemporary. I know that Romanski goes back in history and he takes the historical ballets and he makes them fresh and new for today. So I think that's really interesting. And we have our Wielden and we have our Justin Peck, and they're doing Broadway, they're collaborating with new modern composers. Yeah. So hopefully, I think what's happening is that the dancers are still inspired by those people right now, and that's what's most important.
Obviously, becoming a prima ballerina so young had its advantages, but did your mother ever have any regrets at having started so young? No.
No regrets.
Do you know of any 12-year-old who would regret having left school?
Yeah.
Okay, I think that's for you.
Well, who were your mother's favorite partners?
Well, I think Anton Dolin.
Yeah.
The one who kissed her hand.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I knew him quite well. He was Uncle Pat, because he was Irish. His real name was Patrick, but in those days you had to be Russian if you wanted to be a dancer, so they changed everyone's names. Yeah. He was great. He was just great. Mm. And Mum always said that he always made you feel like you were a queen out there. Mm. You know, she said, you're not a machine. Some days you don't feel so good. Some days your balance is a little bit off. Mm-hmm. Some days you go out and you just can't, you're not in the right mood. Your head mm-hmm. can't get your head in the right space. And he would just touch you mm-hmm. and adjust you. Mm-hmm. And you would be safe with him and he would take care of you and everything mm-hmm. would be great.
Mm. Generous.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Jock Soto was that person for me. So. Mm. Mm-hmm.
Touring is a huge part of the Ballet Russes. Mm. Do you think the internet has impacted how dance and dancers spread their work?
Yeah, hugely. I think a lot of people, I know a lot of dancers who learn roles from the internet. Sarah Lane and Joseph Gorek just taught themselves Flower Festival from YouTube, so yeah, and they saw many versions, and they chose a few versions and picked, you know, the parts they liked, and they collaged their version of Flower Festival. So,
cool.
Yeah, so it's huge, and I think we find choreographers that we want to work with on YouTube, and we find out about other dancers in other parts of the world and what they're doing, and sharing photos on Instagram and Facebook, and making friends all over the world. I have friends in the Kirov that I never really met, but if I did meet them, I did meet one once recently, and I'm like, oh, hey, you know, it's like we know each other, and it really was like that, and but I've really only met him once, mm-hmm. but I know what he's doing every day. He knows what I'm doing every day. He's like, how's Charlie Rose? You know, he knows my cat. So it's huge. We're all friends. It's really interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was the craziest thing that ever happened to your mom on stage? Tamanova and my mother shared the role of Firebird once, and they'd flip a coin for who got opening night. And in New York, my mom got the toss of the coin. And at the beginning of Firebird, the big entrance is from the wing upstage, big jumps across the stage, diagonal, you know, big things. And my mother started, and the first big thing like this, both the straps went, and the costume fell down, exposing her breasts, and her partner, who was Paul Petrov, you know, instead of holding her here, held her like this to hold, and he whispered, don't worry, I'll hold it up. And so they couldn't get off stage. They had this whole pas de deux, and he's holding her here to hold it up. And when they finally, she gets off stage, and you know, De Basile and Karinska, and they're all, what the hell happened?
Oh, we know.
Little razor blade.
Yeah.
Had just cut the two straps just enough so you wouldn't notice until you did that.
Nasty.
No one ever really knew, proved who had done it.
But
Mama Tamanova had been so upset when Tamanova. And they say, so Wendy, what was the craziest thing that ever happened to you?
Me? Nothing. Thank God, like that.
Nothing as sexy as that.
No, nothing as sexy as that. I can't even, nothing really terrible. So.
I can't read without my glasses. What life for a ballerina is like when they retire from the stage? Well, you haven't done that.
Not really, well, a little bit.
Well, you know what my mother did was she taught. She gave master classes, she worked with ballet companies to refresh the Fokin choreography or the Nijinska choreography, the ballets that were made for her and that had gotten fuzzy and muddy over time.
But she stopped dancing quite young.
She stopped dancing when she was 27.
Yeah.
She was touring with Miassine and they were playing stadiums, you know, like rock bands. Mm-hmm. They were playing 10, 15, 25,000 seat stadiums. Yeah. And her feet started to swell up, to fill with water. And Miassine would say, you've got to hang on, just a few more shows. She could hardly get her feet into her shoes. And as they took their curtain call at the end of the last show, they looked down at her feet and he says, "You'd better get to a doctor." And it was a strained heart, you know, from all that touring. Mm-hmm. So she started doing movies then, yeah. And then she met my dad.
Yeah. We were talking before, and I've read some of the book, not all of it. I will, because it's such an amazing book.
I'm just going to click on ahead. Go on.
But I look at the tour schedule that she had, that she started touring and dancing 300 nights a year.
Yeah.
From age 12. She had the length of my career in half the time that I've had. So she doubled up.
There were no unions, you see.
Yeah. So it hits hard.
Beautiful Matisse mask. Yeah, and my mother said, you know, if someone had said, "You can have a day off and tomorrow we'll dance your part," tomorrow, she's like, "The hell
yeah, right.
She no, will, yeah, she's not yeah. dancing my part."
Yeah.
As though they didn't want to have a day off.
Right.
Yeah. Look at that, Nijinska with a cigarette in her hand. And Nijinska always wore white gloves because she didn't like to touch the dancer's sweaty bodies.
Oh.
Les sans baisers. My mother was 16, and this was the first ballet that was made for her, wow. on her.
Wow.
16.
Beautiful. I love that photo.
Yeah. Coq d'Or.
Retmansky just remade that in
oh,
Denmark.
Yeah.
Oh, he loves the historical stuff.
And the ship to Australia. I love this. It says, "Diving at your own risk." Look at those boys.
Crazy.
Yeah. Athletes. Mm-hmm. Arriving in Australia.
There's something about the youth and being fearless. And not yeah. seeing a limit and not seeing the end. And it allows you to do that kind of work.
Yeah. And then you were talking about Prodigal Son.
Right. So we talked about...
Tell.
Well, we spoke about a part that your mother was thought to do, and people wondered, you know, why have you not done this part? Why you should do this role
right.
at ABT,
Giselle.
At American Ballet Theater.
Yes.
Giselle, and they practiced
and
it.
And she rehearsed with Anton Dolin 2 days to do Giselle, and on the second day she said, "No, I'm not working." He said, "Why not?" She said, "I'm not right for the part. I can do the first part, you know, the young girl, and she goes crazy, and I can do that. But when I have to come back as the ghost," she said, "I'm too alive. I'm not ethereal enough physically to be believable as the young girl's ghost. So I can't play this part. I can't dance this part."
Mm. And she never did it.
She never did it. Mm. And it had never occurred to me before then mm-hmm. that a dancer has to be right for the part the way an actor has to be right for the part. Yeah. I thought, well, you know, you dance this and you dance that. And then I thought, of course not.
Yeah.
You're not actually right for every part.
Right.
And so.
Well, one person came up to you once. They said, I had met them at a party, and they said, "Oh, you know, my favorite role you've ever done. I just love how you dance this part. It's the siren in The Prodigal Son. You're incredible in that role." I said, "I've never done that role." "Oh, yes, you have." "No, I've never done that role. You're the best." "No." So, in fact, it is one of my favorite ballets of all time, and it is one of my favorite roles to watch. And I thought for years, why can't I do that part? I'm tall. And in one season, Peter had asked me, "You know, you're not dancing a whole lot right now. Is there something you want to learn or do?" And I said, "Well, I'd love to learn the siren." And he's like, "Really?" I said, "Yeah, really, I would love to learn it. You don't have to cast me in it, of course, but I would just love to learn it. It's like, I wanted to try on the clothes and see how it felt." And clothes were too big. They just didn't fit. I'm too small, I'm too light, I'm too ethereal, I'm too light. It didn't work. It was really interesting to realize that I didn't fit into that for obvious reasons. I just am physically incorrect. So,
Clicking ahead. Last night in Covent Garden before the war. And so World War II started, you know, all the Russian dancers, they didn't have any papers, they didn't have birth certificates, they didn't have passports because they'd run away, they didn't have anything. So they all had to get out of Europe during the war because they couldn't cross the borders with the Nansen papers, the sort of temporary documents that they had. And my mother became one of the founding ballerinas of American Ballet Theatre, where the idea was to create an all-American company. But for the first two or three years, there weren't any American dancers who had big enough names to sell tickets. And so for the company to establish itself and build up a subscription audience and become established, they needed the Russians. And so Alicia Markova, Anton Dolin, and Irina Baronova were the first stars of American Ballet Theatre, which was largely funded by Lucia Chase, who was a pretty good dancer herself. And she roomed with my mom. And they rented some barns at Jacob's Pillow. And
those barns are still there.
You've danced in those
barns. And those photos adorn the barn.
And Fokine made Bluebeard. And there's Tudor partnering my mum in gala performance. And Nora Kay, Annabelle Lyons, Alicia Markova, and Mum in Pas de Quatre. Female Garde. Swan Lake with Uncle Pat. Fokine and Lucia Chase and Vera Fokine and my mum. In Mexico City. Coppelia. And this was with Messine when her feet started swelling up.
Oh, wow.
Nutcracker. And look, I mean, that's how he showed her off when she was 13. And he took her to the front of the stage. And there they are, you know, 45 years later, at the 40th anniversary of ABT. I just think it's so incredibly beautiful and touching. And there's Mum, aged 88. Sitting on the knee of the artistic director of the Australian Ballet, David McAllister. She had been working with them on a Fokine ballet. And then when my mother died and all her papers were sent to me, and that's how I came to make the book, because I was sitting with over 2,000 photographs trying to sort them out and making piles of them on the floor and trying to arrange them chronologically in which ballets. And I thought, there's a life in pictures here. There's the whole story of a life with these beautiful photographs that no one has seen. I could make a book. I could just write enough words to stick them all together. And then in the piles and the passports and the audio tapes, and there was this little silk bag with a zip on the top that hadn't been opened for I don't know, and I managed to get it open, and inside was a pair of pink satin toe shoes. And in my mother's writing, in the lining of one, she wrote Irina Baronova, and in the other, she wrote my last performance. And so her papers are now at the New York Public Library in the dance division, and the headdresses and textile pieces are at the V&A, the Victoria and Albert Museum, with the other costumes that she had given them earlier. And my husband and kids and I were going to go to St. Petersburg for the first time 2 years ago. And we were going to look for Granny's house. And I Googled the Vaganova Academy, the great ballet academy there. And they had a museum. And I Googled the museum. And they had a glass case with a display of pink satin toe shoes in a starburst. And I fired off an email, when it, you know, contact us, to the director saying, I have Baronova's toe shoes, would you like them for your museum? Yes, the email came back right away. And so my husband took this picture of me in the museum. They opened it on a Sunday and showed us around. And and I thought, well, Irina Baronova never got to go home and dance in Russia, but her toe shoes
are
there.
Amazing.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you
so much for this.
Thank you for putting this beautiful book together for all of us to enjoy.
Thank you. My last gift to my mom.
Yeah.
Thank you.